last bit of the quarter. Well, I hope I'm not stressing you guys out too much. Actually, I can keep the last bit simple with just a paper. Does that sound good? It's just taking off on the problems that you guys did already.
Will we have those back?
Yeah.
You will, paper?
Yeah, cool. You will have it back.
Okay.
So tomorrow, Camelia will be here taking the test, giving or taking. I don't know how it. What's the right word? Give the test. Okay. So she'll be here giving the test, and she will bring back those homeworks, and I will have to send her a reminder. I told her once, but I'll just send her a reminder. Homework two is returned. So if some of you didn't get it, email me. Any questions about the paper you have to write? Yeah.
About the presentation. To the 9th, is that correct?
Yeah.
Will we get comments about that? Or
no. I should have given you the comments. So some of you, you've gotten comments from Camelia, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I would say, post it, I will give comments. We still have a few days to finalize it by the end of that week. Right, so it's already posted. So some of you have gotten comments, some of you have not. And so let's see, let's try. Monday, I will post comments for some of you. And which ones I will send you, it's the complimentary set of the ones Camelia did not comment on. So those I will comment on by Monday. And you can post yours by, let's say, Thursday. Let's extend it a little bit so you have a few days to work on it. And basically, by Friday, everything is in. Okay, any other questions on the paper? Okay, good. So the other thing that is posted on the content page, and it says here, background stuff. Background stuff and summary. So I put down some background just because some people were not familiar with normal mode, so I just put like 2 pages of single oscillator and 2 coupled oscillators, nothing really complicated. So okay, this you can look up. It's basically 1D simple harmonic oscillator, etc., etc. You get that frequency of oscillation. And then 2 coupled springs. And this is instructive. If you've done this before in some other course by writing an equation of motion, try to recapitulate that by looking it up. And compare that with the method to write a dynamical matrix. So when you first did it in some mechanics class, you wouldn't have done it this way. You would have written the equation of motion of these 2 coupled springs. Then you would have said, aha, this combination of x1 and x2 diagonalizes my modes and so on. This is another way of doing it. It's like one step. So you just do it by constructing this dynamical matrix, and then right away the eigenvalues of that give you the 2 modes. So I've just done that so you can connect it with something you've seen before. And then the last part just goes over a little bit of the n-site coupled oscillators, okay? And it constructs this dynamical matrix and so on. So this is the background. And then I have the summary. I tried to put it in one sheet and it was just not coming out well. So it's in 3 sheets. And you can make your own summaries like this, but essentially it starts out with the total energy of the crystal, which is a sum of pair potentials. It gives you the dispersion. I've tried to highlight just the key points. So the key points is that you get this, when you have n oscillators, you get modes. And the modes have this energy as a function of k dispersion. What is important is that they are linear at small k, and that's how you get a sound velocity. And these are the typical numbers for a solid, typical solid. And then the next step is we quantize the modes, and then we get a Hamiltonian that looks like this. And n of k is essentially the Bose distribution. The specific heat is the temperature derivative of the total energy. And it essentially boils down to taking a temp, the only place temperature enters is an n of k, so you end up having to take that temperature derivative. And you should know how to get these limiting cases. Okay, but these are the answers. Roughly, you know, 234 is not important. It's a number like 100, t cubed, t over theta divided cubed. So all this is on the web. And again, the fourth concept that's important is density of states. In three dimensions, it goes like omega squared. And that allows you to actually do this energy sum in another way. Here we did it as a function by summing over k. You can also do it by integrating over omega, and that gives you a very quick and cheap way of getting this t cubed, because it's now d omega g omega, the density of states, times this. You try to write everything in dimensionless constants, and you pull out a factor of t to the fourth, and that gives you t cubed. Okay, so the reason I've summarized these is in a typical what do we call them, these exams, not candidacy. What does our department call it? Candidacy? It is, okay. In these exams, you know, we'll typically ask questions like that. And then we'll say, well, can you show this? And, you know, can you, we keep taking you back further and further until it's really something very simple. So these are the kinds of things you want to keep in your mind. Okay, the last part is then, no, not yet. The fifth one is, how do you measure this? Inelastic neutron scattering. Again, the thing to keep in mind is thermal neutrons have energies of order MeV, which is close to the energy of phonons. So that's why these are ideal to use. Also, they are neutral, so they don't interact with a lot of, you know, like Cherenkov and other radiation scattering of the charges. So, and then these are the signatures. In inelastic, you look at intensity as a function of energy lost to the system, E prime minus E, and it gives you these sharp peaks. And so you should have some idea what they mean. And elastic gives you delta functions at the reciprocal lattice vectors whose amplitude is suppressed by the Debye Waller factor, right? So you recognize, we've sort of touched on all these topics and I've just tried to put it all together in one place. And the last part is this elasticity thing, which Mike Fellinger covered. And I just want to stress a few things, because it was a lot of 81 entries in some fourth rank tensor. And I just want to give you a, you know, a very like a bird's eye view of what you want to keep in your mind. So the first thing is, you want to think of energy as half kx squared. That's the elastic energy. And that gets generalized to some object k, and x is the extension. So why are you getting something like a fourth rank tensor? Because each of these extensions, delta u is the displacement. It's the displacement from the Bravais lattice. And that can be in the x direction with respect to a derivative taken in the y direction. So that's why you get alpha, beta, gamma, delta can each be x, y, or z. And that's the origin of the fourth rank tensor. But again, you can keep this in mind, but we don't need to get too fixated on this complex tensor notation. We need only the following key ideas. And those are the, that in a, so you can write this as also some coefficient C, elastic constant C, times these strains, E's. These are the strains, and C is the elastic constant. And so basically, you have these three to think about. So I just want to give you pictures for those. So typically, you would do, if you have a cube, you're going to do two things. One is you're going to do something like a compressibility. You have a solid, you're going to compress it or extend it. And that's captured by CXXXX. And that's essentially saying that I'm applying a stress, let's say, on a along the x direction. Okay, so here is a cube. I'm applying the stress along the x direction. It's applied on the yz plane. And that causes some extension along x. So that's this term, C11. Now, typically what will happen is, you know, if you have played with something like Play-Doh, you try to pull it, it also gets thinner. right? So in the transverse direction, it can change dimensions. And that's why you need this C12, which basically says that if the stress is along X, it can cause changes in dimension along Y. And that's the process of, you know, extrusion. You're thinning it out in the transverse direction. So you need that term. And the last one is a shear. You know, what you think of shear. You're applying something along, you're taking a block and you're shearing it. So that's, these are the three. And so you should have some visual picture of these. And then the most important thing is to remember that these sound velocities that we got are related to these elastic constants. Okay, so if you have a very stiff material, like diamond, diamond has very strong covalent bonds, then the velocity in that material will also be higher. Always remember, air is 300 meters per second. Anything else with interactions in a solid, the sound velocity goes up. So typical solids have sound velocity of 3,000 meters per second. Diamond is even higher, like 5,000 meters per second or something. Okay, and then, you know, Mike showed these numbers for these typical elastic constants. And, you know, he was showing detailed comparisons and all that. But again, in my mind, the key thing to remember is, can we guess the rough magnitude? So all these elastic constants were like 100 gigapascal. Okay, so, you know, what you'll see in typical situations, and this is one of the things I want you to kind of imbibe, is try to kind of independently think about some of these numbers. Because when you go to talks, people will fixate on copper is 1.6 times, 160 gigapascal, and aluminum is 140, and they'll fixate on all these tiny differences. And, you know, the whole talk will be comparing details of 160 versus 140, etc. Take a step back and ask, where is the 100 coming from? Or where is the gigapascal? 10 to the, giga is 10 to the 9, so this is 10 to the 11. Where is the scale coming from? And it turns out, two-line calculation gives you that number. And, you know, once you have that, you know, you say, okay, I'm on firm footing. So the way you can see that is energy is this C times strain square. And strain is dimensionless. It's change in length per unit length. Okay, so C is basically energy per unit volume. And we are taking energies that are essentially of order EV. So you get one EV per one angstrom cubed, and you go through all that, you get 10 to the 11 newton per meter square, which is what is, which is called Pascal. So there it is. Okay, so that's my, that's kind of what I made for the three-phase summary. Any questions?
How did you pick one EV?
Just because...
you're looking at one bond?
Yeah. So it depends on the bonding. Okay, if it's very weak bonding, like some polymeric or thermal effects, if that's important, you have to change that. So most solids have like on order EV bonding. Now in tomorrow's test, you're allowed to bring Ashcroft and Merman, you're allowed to bring your class notes, you're allowed to bring the summary sheet, everything. But you have 1 hour. And you don't have Wikipedia because that makes things complicated. I don't mind Wikipedia, but I don't know if you can all get connectivity. It won't help in my test, I can tell you. But basically, my point is you can have all the resources and then do the test in 1 hour. Okay? Any other questions? Okay. Okay, so now, I want to gear up for today's lecture on thermal conductivity and thermal power, which is a new thing I want to talk about today. And then Yibin, who's been working on this with Jos Hermans in the mechanical engineering department, will tell us a little more about it. So let's just recap from last time. And so we go back now to the Boltzmann equation, and in particular where we apply a thermal gradient. Okay, so here I've just written down the three terms: diffusion, fields, the change in the distribution function due to diffusion, due to external fields, and due to collisions. So what I'm going to do is throw away the fields and just focus on this part, where there's a thermal gradient sitting. And last time I got confused with some algebra, so I've done that again more carefully. So the first point is, we are going to assume linear response. So in this term here, I'm going to just look at, instead of f, I will just look at f0, right? Because I want changes on order of gradient of temperature or whatever is driving it. So let me be explicit here. So a term like this, del f, is basically delta f by delta t, let's say, times gradient of t. And since this is the driving force for the distribution function, and we want terms linear to delta t, we can just take f to its lowest order, which is the equilibrium f0. Okay? And now I want to take some derivative like this, delta by delta r of f0. And this is where I was getting confused last time. And that's because there is actually an error in a couple of books on this. But never mind.
Didn't we switch to delta by delta t?
No, I'm now going back to the original expression.
Oh.
That is where a number of books have made a mistake. Because if this is not, that's why I put a little squiggle here.
Mm-hmm.
A number of books have written this as equal to delta fk by delta t by delta r. But there is another term which they are missing out, which is a change of the chemical. So the point is, when you apply a thermal gradient, you necessarily have to change the chemical potential. Okay, and I'll explain that once again. I did that last time towards the end, but I think you had to go. So I'm going to do that once more. But that's what this term is missing. So I've just put a squiggle there, and a number of books make this mistake. They land on their feet in the end, but then at some intermediate step, they have missed out a term. And that's why I was also getting confused last time. So the point is, I go back to the original expression, which is delta by delta r of f0, okay? And so I need to take delta by delta r of f0 here. And first I do, and that turns out to be this. So this is just the ordinary derivative with respect to this variable. And then you take, yeah. And then, so this is just delta, you know, I take a derivative of this term, and then I get two terms after that, delta by delta r of t, delta t by delta r, and delta mu by delta r. So both of those can depend on r. And that's how, and this term here is nothing but delta f0 by delta e, which is going to be the delta function peaked at the chemical potential. Okay, so with that then, this is the expression that we get, that gk has these pieces here, times delta mu by delta r, and delta t by delta r. Okay, and then it goes into the the rest follows then the way we did last time, and finally you get this matrix equation that you've applied. So this term here, this script E, is this delta mu term. Okay? If you have an electric field, you can slap it in there as well. It just goes in as an addition to the delta mu. Because you can think of electric field as a gradient in the potential. So both chemical potential and the actual electrostatic potential come here. And this is the gradient of the temperature. And in response, what you have is an electrical current and a heat current. Okay, and then we went through some stuff which I'm not going into. But finally, we imposed this condition. We said, okay, suppose I want to be in a situation where there is no electrical current, Okay, so if the electrical current is zero, so I make the first term here zero, that means L11 times E plus L12 times gradient of T must be zero, and that gives me a connection between script E and gradient of temperature. And that is this. So script E turns out to be this set of constants times gradient of T. And JQ is L22 times gradient of T minus L21 times E. From here, this is coming from the second equation, multiplying this row with this column. And for E now, I'm going to put in the condition I got from the first equation. And ultimately, this is the rather complex equation one gets for the thermal conductivity. Okay? So that is where we ended last time. And the point I wanted to make is the following, that when we have, we left off at this place, that when we have a rod where this is hot, let's say this is the hot end, and this is the cold end, I want you to have a visual picture of this delta mu, because that's important. It will play a role now in the next discussion. Okay, so you have a hot end and a cold end. Okay, so I want you to understand, what does it mean to have no electrical current flowing? It basically means that the number of electrons going to the right is equal to the number of electrons going to the left. So there's no net flow. But at the same time, hotter electrons are moving in one direction, so they can carry energy. Now, what's the deal with delta mu? Delta mu is not constant along the rod. And the way that happens, you may think mu controls concentration or the number of electrons. So you may think there is an electron concentration along the wire. That's not correct. What is happening, so you have this, so this is, so N is sum over K F of EP. So you're basically summing this kind of a distribution at whatever temperature. And so what you have is, and F of EK is 1 over E to the beta epsilon K minus mu plus 1. And so what you have is basically the temperature along the rod, this T and mu, are both going to vary in such a way as to keep N constant along the rod. Okay? So that's the point about delta mu. So here we will have a distribution which looks very broad. And here we have a distribution that looks very sharp. Now, both of these will add up. So mu will have to shift such that the number n here and number n here are identical. And in between, so this will generate. So in order to keep n fixed along the wire, along the rod, mu will have to and that is the origin of the del mu. So this is del mu potential. Okay? And the interesting thing is it can be measured. Okay. So now coming to the next part. So any questions on the thermal conductivity? So basically what we are seeing because of that coupled set of equations is that electrical current can drive heat current and heat current can drive electrical current. You know, you have these two things which get linked. So the thermoelectric effect is one such effect, which is quite interesting. Basically, what you start out is you take two metals, and you can take them at different temperatures. At two different temperatures, T1 and T2, and we connect them, but keep them in an open circuit condition. So there's no electrical current flowing because there's an opening here. Okay? And so what I'm going to show you is now this thermal gradient which has been set up. Okay, so you're obviously supplying heat here, taking heat out there, so as to keep these two junctions at different temperatures. Okay, and the net result will be that it will produce a voltage, an electrical voltage in the system. And that is called the thermoelectric effect. Okay, so the way it happens is, again, you go back to that equation, those coupled equations that we had. Maybe it's useful to write that equation on the board. So we have, on this side, we have JQ, and this is this matrix, L11, L12, L21, L22. And then we have E and minus gravity. And E is basically the electric field plus del mu. If J is zero, that tells me that the electric field or the electrochemical potential is L11. So I'm basically multiplying this and this this row and this column, setting it equal to zero, and that gives me this equation here. That Ex is L11 inverse times L12 times dt by dx. Is everyone with me here on this formula? Okay. And this coefficient is called the Seebeck coefficient, or thermopower. This phenomenon is called thermopower, like thermal conductivity. This is a thermopower measurement. And it essentially relates the voltage developed to the temperature gradient. Okay, so if I go along this loop, I can look at the voltage developed by going along this loop. I take my fields integrated dx and so on, and that turns out to be, you can just go through that, it turns out to be the difference of the thermopower of the two materials times dt by dx. So essentially, this is the result, that you've applied a thermal gradient, and you have these two wires, you kept the junction one hot, one cold, and it generated a voltage, delta V. And the proportionality constant depends on some material properties. Okay. Now, there are various ways to calculate S. It's basically given by this product. And I'm not giving you all the details, but it turns out to be related to the following. So there is a term here which is the conductivity at the chemical potential, but really the driving term is the derivative of the conductivity with respect to energy evaluated at EF. And this is known as Mott formula. There are other formulas that exist. So this is not an exact formula. The exact formula would be that you have to do that integral that we derived with some kind of an energy velocity correlation over the Fermi surface. That is the complete formula. But from that, you can come up with some approximate formulas. So this is one of them. There are other formulae, which I will tell you about later after Eugen's talk, it's a very beautiful result where you relate the Seebeck coefficient to the entropy. Okay, That's why you see I suddenly changed my notation to script S, because now I have to relate this script S, which is a Seebeck coefficient, to the entropy. And you can imagine why that is happening. Because you're adding heat to the system, and heat is, you know, fluctuating your system into different available states, and that's really what entropy is. So the Seebeck coefficient turns out to be a very fundamental quantity which gives you information about entropy. But we'll get to that later. Now, you know, Ashcroft and Merman has these absolutely brilliant 1D models for everything: conductivity, thermal conductivity, also Seebeck coefficient. And you know, inexact as they may be, they give you a quick intuitive feel for what the order of magnitude of this quantity is. So we do the same 1D model, and we are going to relate the thermal velocity, the you know, essentially coming from the fact that if I look at the velocity at any point x, it's going to be a combination of electrons coming from the hot end and the cold end, moving in opposite directions, but with different velocities. So here they are. X minus vt, so if I look at a point x, x minus vt was a point to the left before the last collision. And x plus vt is a point to the right before the last collision. And so you put that together, you get d by dx of v squared. Okay?
So moving at different velocities, how is the current zero?
The current is not zero. So this is vq. I just add the two up. So this is the, I'm going to, the thermal current and the electrical current together, the net current will be zero. This is just the energy. So there's some net flow of energy. This is not zero by itself.
Right. Didn't we say the electrical current is zero?
Yeah, I'm going to come to that. This is the heat current, in a way.
Right.
And, okay, so you get this, d by dx of v squared, and then you can write v squared as, you know, sort of, this is a vx squared, which is nothing but a third of v square in a 3D model. And so you get vq is, you know, something like this. So I've written this dv square by dt, dt by dx. So I've moved the x derivative to the temperature, because I know I'm trying to get a coefficient to a gradient of the temperature. And now, okay, that's one part of it. And then I have an electrical current, which is something like this. Now, you know, this is a simplistic model, so we shouldn't take it too seriously. We did not apply an electric field, right? So actually what you want to put here is the chemical potential, which is driving the second part. So this kind of a model is not to be taken too seriously. You have to go back to the actual equations. And then it's very clear that even without an electric field, there is a chemical potential imbalance that gets generated. But Ashcroft and Merman, you know, has a very rough argument like this. So I don't want to go through it with too much emphasis, because it's not correct in detail. But what it does give is, by putting a zero current condition, then you can get that this electric field is minus delta V, and on the other side you have a delta T, and you can read off the coefficient. So in the coefficient, you'll get this term dv squared by dt. And this is nothing but, if I multiply by m, that gives me the energy. Half mv squared is the kinetic energy. So d by dt of this energy, which is the specific heat. So what you end up getting is this behavior, that the Seebeck coefficient, which is the gradient of temperature with respect to the voltage generated, the difference in voltage, is related to these constants, Cv over n, 1 over 3e. The important thing is that there is no tau dependence, okay? And that's why these kinds of numbers are useful. It's like our Lorentz number, where we took a ratio of thermal conductivity and electrical conductivity, and tau canceled out, because we have no idea what tau is. It depends on so many details. And so if you now put some put some estimates here, then the specific heat for a classical system is constant. It's 3/2 nkb. So if I plug that in this expression, I get my Seebeck coefficient, the classical one, is kb over 2e, which is 0.8 times 10 to the minus 4. Okay, another way to say that is, so this is another, this is an important unit that we are getting. Kb over e is roughly, let's say, 80 microvolt per degree Kelvin. Okay, micro is 10 to the minus 6. And for low T, the specific heat is basically the classical value reduced by this factor, kBT over EF. And that means, you can imagine how small it will be. The classical thermopower was 80 microvolt per EF. And now at low temperatures, it will be suppressed by this factor, kBT over EF. So ultimately you get in metals, extremely tiny. So T over TF is like 0.02 or even smaller. You basically get typical thermopower for metals is about 1 microvolt per degree Kelvin. Okay, so that's a number to keep in mind. Okay, so that's also the Peltier effect, but I think what we'll do is, okay, let me just complete this. This is, so actually, let me stop here and see if you have questions. Any questions here? So remember, the geometry is two metals connected. One end is hot, one junction is hot, the other junction is cold. And this thermal gradient drives a voltage between the metals.
Okay. How can you have a voltage if you don't have a more electrons here than there? The concentration has to vary, right?
It's that example I showed you, right? So let's, you can have, so the way to think about it is, your chemical potential is a measure of up to what level you're filling up your Fermi C. Mm-hmm. So you're filling them up to different levels in order to keep a constant density, because the temperature is changing. So your chemical potential, go back to the very first, you know, not very first, but some early homework, where we tried to find the chemical potential as a function of temperature. And you found it started out at EF and then it varied with temperature. It's that phenomena that is going on now. So since the different points are at different temperatures, the chemical potentials also have to shift in order to keep the same constant dense number. And that is what gets measured as a voltage. Okay. And now there's this offers another very related effect called the Peltier effect, where again you take two dissimilar metals. Now you don't keep it open condition. You basically drive, so you're taking a bimetal system at the same temperature. So now it's a reverse phenomena where the temperature is not different. So there's no thermal gradient as such to begin with. So the temperature is uniform everywhere, and you're driving a current with a battery. So you put a battery here in order to drive an electrical current, okay? And now what you find is if you do that, the system will not remain at the same temperature. If you just did this experiment and you took two different metals and drove a current between them, you could not just keep the temperature constant. The temperature at the two junctions will automatically become high and low based on the previous effect, actually. So in order to keep the metals at the same temperature T naught, you have to actually supply heat by putting in heat at one end and taking heat out at the other end. And only then the entire system will remain at the temperature T naught. And this is called the Peltier effect. So again, the way this comes about is JQ, so now there's no thermal gradient. So our first equation becomes J is equal to L11E, right? There's no thermal gradient. the second equation becomes jq is L12E. And then I can substitute for E from the first one and get this combination. So what you have is you're driving it with an electrical current, and it is generating a net heat current, and the coefficient of that is called the Peltier coefficient. Okay, now why are we fussing about these things? Because as Yijin will tell us, they have some fantastic uses. So, okay, Yijin.
So now we have this Zbeckel effect and Peltier effect. There is one additional Thompson effect to complete. So that is like when you apply a current to a kind of material. So in addition to the draw heating, so there's additional heat transport from one end to the other, so that's called Thompson effect. But that's not very important. So in metal, we can, here we show the typical value of Zbeckel coefficient. So again, note that the unit is microvolt Kelvin, and this is the basic constant in Boltzmann constant and electrical charge. So as we can see, it is very small for metals. So we can use them to make thermocouples. That is one of the applications. So we actually make, so they're using the different kind of alloys to make the sensitivity in microvolts per degree centigrade. So they use pure metals. This value is likely to change over temperature. So they, by adding two different kind of metal together, they can make this value a constant over a certain temperature range. So that's why they are using some commercial alloys to make this kind of thermocouple. So, and then we can convert that temperature signal into a voltage signal, which is easy to measure. So, and so as we talked before, the thermoelectric effect in metal are very small, and the Zbeckel coefficient is like 2 microvolts per Kelvin. But in semiconductors, this thermoelectric effect are more dramatic. So, this is a rule of thumb. It's thermoelectric for application will have a Zbeckel coefficient of 200. As so, this silicon is like 400. So just to get an idea, it's order of magnitude larger than what is in metal. So and also it's point. It's interesting to notice that they have p-type and n-type thermoelectric materials. So they are the same as like p-type and n-type like materials. So, but in order to make them work, we have to use both p-type and n-type material to make a. So this is like a thermoelectric cooler, and this is a thermoelectric heat energy generator. So they, so if we use the same p-type material, the voltage will counteract each other, so we are not going to get a current. So if we use p-type, both p-type and n-type material, so the current, this hot and this cold, the current is going to be like this, and in the p-side, it's
it's going to relax it so we can have a curve. So actually, yeah, well.
Actually, just before that, do you see why the thermal, why the seabed effect coefficient could be two orders of magnitude larger or one order of magnitude larger than a metal? You know, two actually compared to a typical metal. Instead of one microvolt per Kelvin, why is it about 100?
Is it easier to develop a voltage across a non-conductor?
What do you think?
So we have that Mohs formula. It's like so for metal, so this value is not likely to change much with temperature, with energy, but in a semiconductor we have, so this is likely to be more with energy compared to metal.
I don't know, but I was just going to make a very simplistic argument that the this is non-degenerate, and you know, we just showed if it was classical, then the entropy was the specific heat was a constant. And if it was a metal, it was suppressed by T over TF. So for a semiconductor,
For some of the materials, the Fermi energy, the Fermi level actually enter the conduction band or the valence band. So we can see that there's a factor of like KT over TF, and for metal, this is very large. For semiconductors, this can be small.
Yeah.
So, but if we cannot tell if that point is the Fermi level is in the forbidden band. So
we can, right? If we know how much doping there is, then we know.
I mean, if the Fermi level is in the band, this formula doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
So if it is heavily doped and the Fermi energy enters the band, so I think this can explain why the semiconductor.
I guess one could even make a prediction based on this that if it's small amount of doping, the thermal power would be higher.
Yes.
And then if you dope it more, the thermal power would come down. Does that actually happen?
Yes, that's
right. Okay, that our intuition may be working. Okay, anyway, go on. You were going to show something.
So this thing is like the same here, so there are different.
Anybody wants to try warm hands and a magic spell?
I'm freezing. So
are there any other heat sources?
I tried this.
There's no one in here. You need someone to flick it while you have your hands on it?
Jennifer, you want to? With your hands on it.
You want to have something cold that you can put on the other side?
You want to give
Abby? Oh, well.
Give me a little push down.
So it's the...
So tell us in detail what is happening and what you're made of.
So, I see... The temperature difference between the top and the bottom of it will generate a voltage, and that's driving the fan only.
So this temperature difference is what, like 2 degrees?
I don't know, it's the...
No, all the bottom blocks probably at like 70 room temperature, but we're at 98.
Oh, roughly. Yes, you're right. We are warm blooded.
It's more like 30 degrees.
Okay, good, good. We are, okay, that's right. So 30 degrees, and then you multiply, you have some three factor.
So I've got a multimeter.
Oh, good, good.
So
30 degrees.
It's like 18.5 per nanometer.
So,
then,
so it's reading.
What's your prediction?
20 microvolts.
It's
smaller.
47.
Why is it more compact?
How much? Wait, do you want to just work it out? How many degrees did we say? 30 degrees. 30 times what? What is this material?
So, I mean, they are like connected in a series, so this would be multiplied by the number.
Okay. Yeah.
By the number of elements.
By the number of these loops, right? Okay.
What did
like
you
NP.
What did you measure?
The voltage generated. So, and this is...
Okay, so what was the number? Let's write it down, because this is our data.
43 what?
So you said 43?
43.
Now, what's the unit? Must be millivolts. Must be millivolts. This is voltage. And we had delta T, we said was about 30 degrees.
Yeah, but it was for 15 Kelvin or something.
Yeah. So our S is like 3. Millivolt per Kelvin. Right? That's huge. Oh,
yeah,
because
but
of
divide by the number of elements.
Right. Divided by number of junctions. So it's that's the number. 3 millivolts. So that's a huge enhancement.
Any idea how many components
yeah.
are there?
I don't know. So
okay.
And I don't know. Actually all they
are connected. So it's called a 10. Is that a part of
300 microns. Maybe they connect some of them in series and some of them in parallel to increase the current output.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know. And this is another thing that demonstrates the Peltier effect. So they have batteries inside, and so if you turn it on, you can. Put a drop of water on it, and it will freeze.
Okay, so let's sit on it.
getting cool, but another side must be getting hot.
Yeah.
Where is
but
that?
Well, so that's...
Is there an opposite side?
Yeah, I think the whole back is the opposite. So they are using the convective heat conduction to dissipate the heat. So if, actually, if I reverse the current, that will get hotter and melt. But I think they don't do it because it may be just a resistor and that is heating up. So one important thing for the thermoelectrics is this kind of dimensionless figure of merit is defined as the Seebeck squared times conductivity T over kappa. So I'll show why this is important because so first we can note that so this is a dimensionless parameter and that's important because it appears in the formula for the efficiency for thermoelectric heat generation or the cooling. So we have here, this is the Carnot efficiency, that is the maximum heat engine we get, and this we have this vector is only the function of Zt. So I'll show that the higher Zt we have, the higher efficiency we got, but also note that it is comparatively low, only a small proportion for the of that kernel efficiency, and it's like you can see it's for two is like 30% of the kernel efficiency, and Zt of three is probably impossible to get. So, and again, this is the coefficient of performance for regeneration, refrigeration, and that is, so they have those kind of modules, and they predict if the Zt is like two, it is comparative to the vapor compression refrigerator. So, but generally, it has lower efficiency than those conventional modules. So, and we can see that if we do some algebra for the Zt, we can divide it by kappa over sigma t, which is the Lorentz number we could derive. So, the Lorentz number is like this, pi squared over three, and this is Boltzmann constant over electron charge. So that's why, so we can see that this Zt parameter is dimensionless, and know that if we have a Zt of like two times this value, and Zt is likely to be over one. But and another issue is here, if we apply this formula, we are neglecting the lattice contribution to the thermal conductivity, which is not true for semiconductors. So for semiconductors, if we do such like Lorentz number, it will be larger than this value. So as we can see here that it will be useless to use metals to do this thermal electrical application. I should be explain some more why the Zt has this kind of format. So first we wanted the Seebeck, the thermoelectric phenomenon to be large. And also we do not want its heating because of its resistance. So that's why we want the electrical conductivity to be small. And also we want to keep that temperature difference.
You want conductivity to be large, right?
Yeah. So the conductivity should be large and the thermal conductivity should be small because we want to sustain that temperature difference that is generating our electricity, or we generated that the heat temperature difference through our refrigeration. So that's why ZT has this form. So the higher ZT, the higher performance we have.
So let's see, your bottom line conclusion is metals are out because ZT is like 0.01.
Yeah.
And that's mainly happening because, okay, it's S itself is small, like 1 microvolt per Kelvin,
yeah.
But L also is huge. I mean, L is like 100. And so you're 100 squared in the denominator.
Not squared.
No, L is kV over E whole square. And
so
each kV over E is like 100. Is that?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, how does it play out in the semiconductor? S is up by, okay, you have
so, so this is a comparison. We can see the feedback coefficients. You are magnitude larger, and also the conductivity is smaller. And so this is like the theoretical value for metal, the Wigman-Franz law. And this is larger because there's a large contribution from the lattice heat conduction. So we have this ZT for metal is very small, and for semiconductors, so this is not an optimized semiconductor for some electric application, but we can see it may be useful.
So that's an important number. So a couple of things that are interesting here. First of all, look at kappa. In a metal, it's 400. In a semiconductor, it's like order one. So what you see here is electrons. In a metal, electrons carry heat as well as the lattice carries heat. But the lattice part is the same as what it would be in a semiconductor. So this itself is telling you that electrons are more efficient at carrying heat. So that's an interesting number. And then the thing to keep in mind is the ZT, finally, that Yibin was talking about. We want to get it around 2 or 3. So if anybody has great ideas, there are big bucks to be made here.
So here are some applications. So they are selling some cooler. I think this is useful because it's portable and maybe used in cars. Like a some electric cool chair, and it can also use like it's actually a temperature controller. You can heat it up or cool it down. So actually, that company is giving us support for our research. And this is one of the interesting application that I think people in NASA are using this radioactive isotope to generate some heat and using some electric module to convert that into electricity to power some of MN space probes. So this is one of typical example where the thermoelectrics can be useful. It is when the efficiency is not your top concern. So for this, for those space missions, the energy availability and the reliability is the outweighed concern for efficiency. So here some of for the advantages of thermoelectrics. So first you can see it's no moving part, it's pure solid state energy conversion. So it's like a heat engine, but the working fluid is electrons in your metal. So there's one advantage there's no vibration or noise. So I think they use this for some electrical or for mobile. Maybe they don't want that vibration. And also it's scalable. We can make things. So some of the small electric module are made by thin films. So they are used for a whole of a CPU and the temperature control panel and reliable. So they, that's why they're using a space mission and that's amazing when they're using it for pacemaker.
For the pacemaker, it's just using the model of the body's thermal energy to create
electricity? No, it's, well, strange enough, it's pretty active, I suppose.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I never imagined.
Trade a heart problem for something else.
Well, I guess maybe it might be well shielded.
Sure.
Because otherwise, it's not.
Your body, but you know, probably people who have pacemakers have them because they can't move very much. Otherwise, then I would think if you're moving, you can use or you're running or you're jogging or whatever, you generate that and you can store it.
Another
issue
is that thermal electric module is inside your body, so it has a certain temperature, I mean, higher than the outside ambient temperature, but there's not much
gradient
inside the body.
Yeah.
Right.
That's why they're using it.
Sure.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
More questions for
Ibi?
That was pretty neat.
Yeah, you said that they were unreliable. What eventually would make them break down?
Well, the one thing, if they are working at higher temperature, the material will actually maybe change. So if you dope them, they may the composition may change, but just after a very long time scale. So otherwise, there's nothing that breaks.
So I know that we use these for laser control, to control the temperature of a laser so that its wavelength doesn't fluctuate. How does it seems like that this thing maintains a certain temperature difference between its hot and cold ends? How does it maintain a fixed temperature on the cold end?
So I think it is just maybe it's not maintained by the thermoelectric module. It's just when your sensor detects there's like temperature surge, it will activate as a thermoelectric cooler to cool it down.
Sure. Okay.
Okay, very nice.
Thank you.
Any thermoelectric effects, and I think you know having these demos gives us a very good feel for you know how those equations you know you can see these how they play out. Now, one thing which we haven't talked about is so actually before coming to that, let's talk a bit about these L. I mean, these are actually matrices, right? So I want to just bring up a couple of cases where the matrix structure may be important. So let's just look at J equal to L11, and let's say there's an electric field. And this is a matrix. And this matrix is what we call sigma. That's the conductivity matrix, right? So we talked about this sometime back. If we were looking at this matrix in a basis which was the principal axes of the material, sigma would typically be diagonal. Let's say sigma xx, sigma yy, sigma zz.
And the only reason for them to be different is if somehow you had, you know, some anisotropy in the system. So X direction was very different from Y and so on. So a layered material would have these differences. Now, under what conditions could you get off diagonal elements? Like here. When could that happen? So what I'm trying to say is, when you look at sigma xx, what are you doing? You are looking at an electric field in the x direction and measuring current in the x direction. Sigma yy is electric field in the x, electric field in the y, current in the y. And as I said, the only reason they would be different is if there was some anisotropy. Now, when could you get sigma, let's take this element here, sigma xy. Sigma xy would be something like ey, and then this is equal to jx. So you're getting a current in, you're applying an electric field in the y direction, but somehow you're getting a current in the x direction. How could that happen? Pardon? Yes. What is the basis of that Hall effect? What are you doing? A magnetic field. So that's another thing that we haven't discussed so far, is a magnetic field. So a magnetic field can give you off-diagonal elements, like this. Okay, and so we'll talk about that next time. And we'll look at this Hall effect. And there's another aspect of off-diagonal elements in the heat part. You know, so this so just like this can have off-diagonal elements, which are called Hall effect, the thermal part can also have off-diagonal elements. Does anyone know what that is called? Off-diagonal elements in the thermal part. So it's sort of like saying you're applying a thermal gradient in the x direction, but then you're getting a response in some y direction. Again, because of a magnetic field. It's only a magnetic field which can rotate it. But when it happens in the thermal part, it's called the Nernst effect. And that has also emerged as a very important effect for strongly interacting systems. Now, we won't discuss that, but I will discuss the Hall part, these things, next time. And so that's a part of the story next time. And there's another part which, again, I won't discuss, and it's called thermomagnetic effects. Again, magnetic fields can cause heating. So that's thermomagnetic, just like thermoelectric, and you know, so on. It kind of goes on, because you can have, so essentially what you're seeing is charge coupling to energy, to heat, and generating thermo something effects, electric, magnetic, and you can also have situations in which the lattice may be involved. So you have some kind of a lattice with some orbitals, and it can cause some kind of orbital effects coupled with magnetism and charge. So it's these are the different things that come up. Okay, so that's pretty much it. Let me just tell you one more thing of where we are headed. So next time I'm going to cover magnetic field effects, and then one more topic is left, and that is AC conductivity. So basically the response to an electric field that is varying in time. And that will kind of wrap up our discussion this quarter. Okay.
Next time is a week from
today? Yeah. Next time for the lecture is a week from today. But you do have your test tomorrow. And I think you like the test. It's a very it's a simple test. You have all the notes. And there's one really nice question there, which I'm very excited about.